church freely, and please bless the preaching day and the soul winning as well. We ask that you open the hearts of the people and let them be receptive to your word, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, the title of my sermon this morning is
The Reprobate Doctrine. The Reprobate Doctrine. Look down at verse number 8 of Hebrews chapter number 6. The Bible reads, "But that which beareth thorns and briars is rejected, and is nigh unto cursing, whose end is to be burned." Now let's look at this passage, jump back to verse number 4, and let's kind of get this passage in context. The Bible says, "For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened, and have tasted of the heavenly gift, and were made partakers of the Holy Ghost, and have tasted the good word of God, and the powers of the world to come," look at verse 6, "if they shall fall away." Now, what you have to realize is that's kind of almost like a sort of a run-on sentence. It's one sentence. It's just very long, you know, from verses 4 to verse 6. See, because I've heard this verse taken a lot, and people have used it and taught that you could lose your salvation. But if you read the verse, actually what it says, it said it's impossible for these persons that it describes in the latter part of verse 4 and verse number 5, these persons, if they fall away, to renew them again to repentance. So if this set of verses was teaching that that you could lose your salvation, then once you lose it, you can't get it back, okay? If this is your go-to passage, but we know that you can't lose your salvation. The Bible says, "And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish." Once you trust Christ for salvation, you can never lose that salvation. No matter what you do, you'll be saved, and when you die, you'll go to heaven. But look at verse number 6, "If they shall fall away, to renew them again unto repentance, seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of God afresh, and put Him to an open shame." So what the Bible says here in verses 4 and 5, you look at some of the language. These people were enlightened. They were given the knowledge of salvation. They were given knowledge of that they are in a sinful condition and they need a Savior. They may not have heard a clear presentation of the gospel, but they have been enlightened to a degree. They've tasted the heavenly gift. They've not eaten of the bread of life. They've just tasted it. They were made partakers of the Holy Ghost, which we'll get to that in just a little while. It says they've tasted the good word of God and the powers of the world to come. So they know that they are a sinner in need of a Savior. They realize that. They've been enlightened by that. And they've fallen away from that. And it says it's impossible if they fall away from the grace of God, if they've departed from that, that it's impossible to renew them again to repentance. And it said that they crucified to themselves the Son of God afresh, meaning after they get past that point of no hope, it's not like Jesus is going to come back and die for that person the second time. The sacrifice has been done, and we have to trust what's already been done. It says, "For the earth drinketh in the rain, that which cometh oft upon it, and bringeth forth herbs and meat for them by whom it is dressed, receiveth blessings from God. But that which beareth thorns and briars is rejected, and is nigh unto cursing, whose end is to be burned." So again, we're talking about the reprobate doctrine this morning, and a lot of people balk at this doctrine, or they get angry at this doctrine, but this is clearly what the Bible teaches. Jeremiah chapter number 6, verse 30, the Bible says, you can jot this down, it says, "Reprobate silver shall men call them, because the Lord hath rejected them." Reprobate, if you just go to dictionary.com, that's an independent fundamental Baptist site. If you go to dictionary.com and you look it up, reprobate means a depraved, unprincipled, or wicked person, a person rejected by God and beyond the hope of salvation. So I think whoever manages, is probably an independent Baptist that manages dictionary.com. But folks, there are people that are alive and breathing right now that have been rejected by God. They have no hope of salvation no matter what that person does. A lot of people will criticize us for having this belief, and I believe that's what the Bible teaches. And actually, an acknowledgement of this doctrine that it's not God's not the God of infinite chances, and it's not this whole it's never too late. By acknowledging that doctrine, it makes you realize that opportunities that we have to lead our brothers and sisters, to lead our family, to lead the lost to Christ, those opportunities are not forever. John chapter 9, verse 4, Jesus says, "I must work the works of Him that sent me while it is day." He said, "For night cometh when no man can work." So Jesus says there comes a point in time that you can't work, that no one is going to be able to work. And there comes a point in people's life, folks, that whenever they can become rejected by God. And that's why it's important that we get busy as Christians spreading the gospel and shining the light of Jesus Christ. Go to Hebrews chapter number 2. But I'd like to prove this from the Bible. and have us look at this reprobate doctrine. And we could go into countless examples of this throughout the Bible, of some of the characteristics of reprobates, and we're not really going to delve into that in this sermon. But number one, all men have opportunity. Folks, we're not Calvinists here, okay? We reject all 5 points of Calvinism. Calvinism is a doctrine, it's a theological doctrine that was started by John Calvin in the 1500s. He's one of a member of the Protestant Reformation. And Calvinism teaches this doctrine. You can sum it up in its acronym called TULIP, T-U-L-I-P. And we can go in that, but I'm not going to for sake of time. But the L in TULIP is limited atonement. And what they teach is that Jesus only died for the elect. That's what they teach, that Jesus did not die for every man, that his sacrifice, his blood was only shed for those that God chose to be ordained unto salvation. But no, we believe that Christ died for all men, everyone, okay? Look at Hebrews 2, verse number 9. The Bible says, but we see Jesus, who is made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, look what the Bible says, by the grace of God should taste death for how many?
Every man.
Now, do we all have King James Bibles in here?
Yeah.
Right. John 3:16, folks, it says, for God so loved the world. I can take any 5-year-old and ask them, what does that mean? And they'll tell you it's everybody, okay? 1 Timothy 2:4, you don't have to turn there. The Bible says, who will have all men to be saved and come under the knowledge of the truth. 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. It's God's desire that no one would go to hell, that all would come to repentance. Hey, if Calvinism were true and God had his way and he was sovereign and he chose who went to heaven or hell, hey, he'd choose that everybody went to heaven. Hey, the hell was not made for the unsaved. Hell was prepared for the devil and his angels. God didn't, men go to hell obviously because they sin, but hey, the original design was for the devil and his angels. Go to Revelation 22, Revelation chapter 22, last chapter in the Bible. Last chapter in the Bible. But we get accused of that by saying, hey, there's some people rejected by God, and they'll make statements, oh, you guys must be Calvinist. No, we're not Calvinist. We believe that God so loved. Hey, there's a couple of letters on the end of loved. ED, that means past tense. At one point in everybody's life, whenever any baby is born, God loves that baby. God loves that baby. God has a desire for that baby, for that child, for that human being to trust Him for salvation. David said that he saw some kind of chat or forum or something like that. I don't know where people started having this discussion. Would you kill baby Hitler? They said if you could go back in time whenever Hitler was a baby and you could just, you know, kill Hitler, and that's a bizarre way of thinking, okay? That's a bizarre argument. God desired, hey, God loved Hitler. Everybody understand that? God so loved the world. God loved Jeffrey Dahmer. God loved Ted Bundy. God loved these serial killers. There was one point in their life that they had the ability to trust Christ for salvation. They had that ability. Everybody does. Every single person on the earth. Look at Revelation 22, verse 17, and the Spirit of the bride say, come, and let him that heareth say, come, and let him that is athirst come. Look what the Bible says, and whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. Everyone, whosoever will, has that opportunity in their life to believe on Jesus Christ. Go to John chapter number 1. John chapter number 1. The Gospel of John chapter 1, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Everybody that comes into this world, every person that's born into this world has a little bit of light. They have a little bit of faith. John chapter 1, verse number 9. John 1, 9. The Bible says, that was the true light which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. Amen. Romans chapter 12, verse 3 says, God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. We are all born in this faith, and we have that capability of having faith, of having light. And immediately, whenever we're born into this world, the devil's goal is to try to extinguish that light. Look at John 1, 4. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Jump to John chapter number 3. John chapter 3. The Bible says, this is the condemnation, that light is coming into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. Now go to John 16. So God sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to die for the sins of mankind. 2,000 years ago, God took every one of your sins, the sins that are known to you, the sins that you would be willing to tell me about, and the sins that you've not told a soul, the sins that nobody in this room knows about, that only you and God, he took every one of your sins and he laid it on Jesus Christ and he died for every single one of your sins. Amen. I was listening to that song on the way to church this morning, It Is Well With My Soul. That middle verse, that second verse, and that said, he took my sins. He said, my sins, not in part, but the whole. Amen. Every one of your sins. You think about it. One sin's going to send you to hell, and God took every single one of them and he laid them on Jesus Christ 2,000 years ago, and he died for every one of your sins. Hey, Jesus is the way, he's the truth, he's the light. He's the light of the world. We are to be the light, pointing the lost to the Savior. God sent his Holy Spirit in the world to bear witness to the light. Look at John 16, verse number 7. John 16, verse number 7. Jesus says, nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away, for if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you, but if I depart, I will send him unto you, and when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin, look what the Bible says, because they believe not on me. So one of the duties of the Holy Spirit is he deals with the hearts of men. He reproves men of their unbelief, and he tries to stir their hearts and their minds to understand the truth. That's one of his responsibilities. Now go to Matthew chapter 13. Matthew chapter 13. There's an opposition to the truth, though. There's an opposition to opportunity. Because number one, all men have opportunity. Number two, all men face opposition. All men face opposition. Look at Matthew 13, verse 18. Hear ye therefore the parable of the sower. When anyone heareth the word of the kingdom. So somebody preaches the gospel to him. It says, and understandeth it not. So they hear the gospel. Maybe they don't get a good gospel presentation. Maybe the soul winner wasn't thorough. Maybe they didn't have time. Who knows? But look what it says. Then cometh the wicked one, that's the devil, and catcheth away that which was sown in his heart. This is he which receiveth seed by the wayside. So the devil's goal, go to 2 Corinthians 4. The devil's goal is to catch the gospel, is to catch the word. He's coming to catch it, that which was sown in the heart of the unbeliever. His goal is to catch that and to remove that, lest that seed could become watered, lest that seed can become more ingrained in that person, and that's his responsibility. John 8:44 says, when he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he's a liar and the father of it. The devil's constantly trying to pervert. He's trying to twist people so their eyes can't be focused or open to the truth. His goal, he don't care if you taste. He doesn't want you to eat. He didn't care if you're enlightened. He don't want you to understand. That's his goal, is that people will not believe the gospel. And the devil's always on the job. There was a lady, a little old lady. She had something nice to say about everybody. I mean, she never had a bad thing to say about anybody. And her pastor's kind of getting worried about it. He thought, this lady lives in la-la land. So he's like, well, I'll just kind of test this theory out. So he walks up to her and he says, ma'am. He said, what do you think about the devil? And the lady says, well, he's always on the job. So, I mean, she had something positive to say even about the devil. Look at 2 Corinthians 4. It says, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, and whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel. See, what's going to happen? Pay attention to these verses. What's going to happen if the devil doesn't blind their eyes? If he doesn't blind their minds, the Bible says. Lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. So his whole goal, his whole purpose in blinding their minds is to prevent the light of the glorious gospel to shine unto them and that they would get saved. It says, for we preach not ourselves, but Jesus Christ the Lord, and ourselves servants for Jesus' sake. For God, look what the Bible says, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Hey, the devil is actively trying to blind the minds of people. I told my wife, I said, you know, it's such... You notice the Bible uses the term about overcoming whenever you get saved. Because you have to overcome a lot. Because your average Joe citizen wakes up in the morning and they get bombarded with the devil's tools to try to blind them, lest they should see the light of the glorious gospel. You think about it. We go out soul winning, and you knock someone's door. What's the chances that that door is going to get knocked again? You talk to your coworker. You talk to someone at the gas station. You talk to someone at the grocery store and try to share the gospel with them. That is just, I mean, that is just a grain of sand on a beach compared to what the devil puts in to trying to influence them and blind them. Look at the TV. Majority of people will wake up in the morning, they'll turn the old idiot box on, they'll turn the television program on, they'll get programmed by television, they leave there, they walk out, they get in their car, they turn on the radio, more indoctrination, they go to work, they start talking to otherworldly people, they start surfing Facebook, they start surfing social media, more indoctrination from the devil, and then they go home and they listen to the radio on their commute home, more indoctrination, and they go home, they have dinner, and then they'll turn on the TV, more indoctrination. Constantly, the devil is blinding them and putting layers and layers and layers of blinding agents on their eyes, because, and it's hard for them to come to that knowledge of Christ, that saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Go to 2 Timothy chapter number 3. The Bible says that God commanded us to shine our lights out of darkness. Folks, the darker the world gets, the brighter we need to shine. So why is the world so dark? Because Christianity's so dim. You know, flashlight technology is fantastic. You know, I got all the dads a flashlight for Father's Day gift, because you can't have too many flashlights because your kids take and burn the batteries out of like four of them. You know, and you need something. You know, there's some intruder at your house and you're looking for a flashlight. They're all in your kids' beds and they're dead. So. Can't have too many flashlights, but flashlight technology is just, you know, it's crazy compared to what we dealt with when we were kids, you know. You were kids, you had the little plastic, you remember the little plastic flashlight that Ever Ready. And it had the two D batteries. And I mean, literally, you'd turn the thing on, like you were in bunk beds, you'd turn the thing on, you could barely see the top bunk. It was just so dim. You know, the candle power, that just technology of flashlights is just, you know, crazy now. But folks, hey, Christianity is so stinking dim. We're like that ever-ready flashlight, that junky ever-ready flashlight. We're like the Dora Explorer flashlights, okay? We're not the surefire, you know, tactical flashlights. And the world's sinking into darkness, and eventually it's going to sink into a reprobate society. Why? Because Christianity's so stinking dim. And you know, and you say, well, how's that my fault? You know, you have to do your part. But folks, Christianity, the bulbs have been dimming. The batteries have been going dead for decades. You understand me? The amount of soul winning that's going on right now, the amount of soul winning, hey, it's not what it was 20, 30 years ago. Everybody understand? People that used to go soul winning, they don't go soul winning anymore. Churches that used to go soul winning, they don't go soul winning anymore. They do the door hanger junk. Door hanger, that's your ever-ready flashlight. Hey, we have the surefire flashlights. Hey, we have, you know, the million candle power. I'll tell you a funny story about a flashlight. I don't know what popped in my head. I worked a wreck one time, and there was a car in the ditch. Nobody was hurt, so don't panic. But, you know, the wrecker driver was pulling this vehicle out, and he was having some difficulty. And it was about dusk. You know, he couldn't really see very well. Well, here comes this guy. He's running. You know, traffic was backed up on both sides of the road. And here comes this guy, he's running, and he's got a suit on that looked like he made it out of hotel drapes. And so he runs up in his old tacky suit, and he had, you remember those lantern lights that they sold that were kind of popular for a while? And literally this thing had, it was like a manhole cover, the size of the front of that, it was huge. I don't know where he got it. But he runs up there, and he says, I have a flashlight if they need it. And I said, no, man, I said, he's already got it hooked up, he's pulling it out. And the guy's like, okay. And he turns around. I told the policeman that I was with, I said, he's probably had that thing three Christmases and he's been looking for an opportunity to use that flashlight. And I just shot him down. Poor guy. I should have told him, like, bring that thing over there, you know. Turn that thing on. I sprayed it and set the car on fire in the field. I kid you not, the lens on that thing, and I mean, it's enormous. It's like a manhole cover. I don't know where he got it. But hey, we need to be that million candle power lantern as Christians. As churches, you imagine if every church, if every Christian in every Baptist church in Knoxville, hey, let their light shine before men. You imagine that. You imagine if we were out soul winning and we just run across scores and scores of people. Yeah. Some apartment complex. Hey, what are you guys doing here? Well, there's like 500 of us here. What you going to do about it? That's why the world's so stinking dark, folks. Because you can't even see your hand in front of your face with the light that your average non-denom church is giving off. We need to shine brightly. Look at 2 Timothy 3. It's kind of a description of mankind in the last days. Look what it says. This knoweth also that in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lover of pleasures more than lovers of God. If you don't believe that, go to the lake. Okay, go to the mountains. Go to Cade's Cove if you don't believe that verse. Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women, laden with sins, led away with diverse lust, ever learning, pay attention to this, and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth, men of corrupt minds. The Bible says they're reprobate concerning the faith. Hey, there's going to be more and more people that are reprobate as time goes on, as we get into the last days. Go to Romans chapter number 1. Romans chapter 1. So number 1, all men have opportunity. Just because we believe that God rejects people, and He does, doesn't mean they've never had an opportunity to be saved, or that they were born and God's just, you know, chose them and says, you know what, you're rejected. I don't like your hair, you know. I don't like the way you hold your pacifier. You're rejected forever. All men have opportunity, and all men are going to face that opposition of the devil trying to blind your eyes continually. Folks, hey, and that's another thing. Don't get all tore up about your family. If your family's not on board with soul winning and the King James Bible and all these things, don't get so tore up about them. Realize the fact that if your family just constantly bombards their brain with TV and news and all this garbage, hey, it's literally like you have to peel the layers back. The layers of propaganda, the layers of programming, you have to peel those things back. So don't just kind of look at your family and be like, well, you know, they're wicked. You know, they can't get to where I'm at. You know what? Hey, at one time, you probably weren't where you're at right now. Okay? Yeah. Romans 1. Genesis 6:3 says, and the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man. You know, we were talking about the Holy Spirit trying to deal with the hearts of mankind. Well, at some point in a person's life, and I don't know where that point is, it's not like that I have just the magic, you know, recipe of when this happens, but the Holy Spirit will stop dealing with that individual. He ceases dealing with that person. He's not going to strive with them anymore. To strive means to fight with someone. And the Holy Ghost is out right now in the world trying to persuade people, trying to reprove them of their unbelief. He is trying to work in the hearts of people to come to that knowledge of Christ, that saving knowledge of Christ. And at some point, the Bible says that my spirit will not always strive with man, that will stop. You know, a lot of people say as long as there's breath, there's hope. Well, I'd love to believe that, you know. I'd like to believe that. I'd like to believe in that. I'd like to believe in unicorns and all sorts of stuff. You know, there are all kind of neat stuff I'd like to believe in. But folks, even if there's no reprobate doctrine, even if this doctrine was completely false or not taught in the Bible, how many people can't physically believe during the last moments in life? Huh? What about a car wreck? Aneurysm, stroke, unresponsive, ventilator, hallucinating, something like that. You never know. You know, you get somebody that's like, you know, that would say, well, I don't believe that God gives up on anybody or whatever, some unsaved person. They get out here and have a car wreck, and the next thing, they never wake up. They're in the hospital on a ventilator, unresponsive, can't hear anything. You can't reason with it, can't understand that person. Everybody understand? So you don't want to just, you know, test God. Look at Romans 1:18. The Bible says, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. So it's not that these people, they don't know the truth, but their truth is in unrighteousness. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of Him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even His eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. The Bible says that you can look at creation. You can look at the sun, moon, and stars. You can look at all of the natural things that God has created, and you can know that there's a Godhead. You can know that He is all-powerful. His eternal power, His Godhead, is made manifest through His creation. And the Bible says, when they knew God, verse 21, they glorified Him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart, look what it says, was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like a corruptible man, and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Wherefore God, look what it says, also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts to dishonor their bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise, so it means the same way, also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error, which was meet. And even as, that means the same way, they did not like to retain God in their knowledge. They don't want to think about God. They don't want to entertain God in their knowledge. They don't want to think about God. Look what it says. The same way that they didn't want to think about God, God gave them over to a reprobate or a rejected mind to do those things which are not convenient. Over and over in this passage, we see God darken their heart. God gave them up to uncleanness. God gave them up unto vile affections, and then God gave them over to a reprobate mind. Go to John chapter number 12. But you know, we get accused a lot. What got the ball rolling in Romans 1? Was it homosexuality? That's kind of where we end up. But is that what got the ball rolling? No, you know what got the ball rolling is the fact that they could look at creation and say, you know what? I know that there is an all-powerful God out there. I know. They know His eternal power and Godhead, and they rejected that. And they became vain in their imaginations. And God said, you know what? You want to reject me? You want to reject the knowledge of God? Hey, I'll give you over to those vain imaginations. Their foolish heart, He says, I'll darken your heart. And then they start going down this road of depravity. So that's what got the ball rolling, folks. John chapter 12, verse 36. The Bible says, while ye have light, believe in the light, that ye may not be the children of light, or that ye may be the children of light. These things spake Jesus, and departed, and hid Himself from them. But though He had done so many miracles before them, yet they believed not on Him. So what are they doing? They're not believing. They're rejecting Him. That the saying of Isaiah the prophet might be fulfilled, which he spake, Lord, who hath believed our report? And to whom hath the arm of the Lord been revealed? Therefore, look what the Bible says. They could not believe, because Isaiah said again, He hath blinded their eyes. Who did? God did. And hardened their hearts. Who hardened their hearts? God did. That they should not see with their eyes, nor understand with their heart, and be converted, and I should heal them. So it is God that is doing the blinding, God that is doing the hardening, God that is doing the darkening, God is doing the giving up. He is. And you know, they can't believe, they can't see, they can't understand, and God has removed from them their opportunity to get saved, and they are rejected. And folks, that's why it's important to trust Christ for salvation right now. For when we go out and we preach the gospel to people, yeah, you can't make people, you can't get them in a headlock, you know, if they don't trust Christ for salvation. But it's important right now. I mean, if you're not saved in here, and I mean, I would dare say probably 99% of people in here are saved. But if you're not saved, hey, you need to get saved today, because you're not promised tomorrow. You never know. You know, and we don't know where that line is. But the Bible says that these people knew God. It's not that they never had an opportunity. It's not that they never had the capability of trusting Christ for salvation, because the Pharisees had the ability to believe on Him. They rejected Him over and over and over and over again. By the time we get to John chapter 12, there's been scores of sermons that Jesus has preached, scores of admonitions that He's given them, and He said, though He had done so many miracles upon them, proving that He was the Son of God, yet they believed not on Him. And at that point, God hardens their heart. He darkens their eyes. Folks, there are people out here that reject God to a certain point that God is going to harden their heart. He's going to blind their eyes. He is going to stop up their ears. They're not going to be able to be saved. They are beyond the hope of salvation. The Bible says, therefore they could not believe. Hey, if you can't believe, how are you going to get saved? Because how do we get saved? Believe. So if you can't believe, then how do you get saved? That's like saying, jump over this building to be saved. You know, who can do that? Nobody can. I always tell people, you know, we're talking about come short of the glory of God. I said, if me and Michael Jordan tried to jump over this building, who could jump over this building? They said, neither one of you. I said, who would get closer? They said, well, Michael Jordan would. Exactly. But can he still jump over that building? Can he still hit that mark, make that mark? No, he can't. So we need to make sure that whenever we preach the gospel, God, that we're thorough with it. that we're not, you know, lackadaisical, because, I mean, it could be the last opportunity this person has. We don't want to walk away from that person and then never have another opportunity to be saved. But folks, America, you know, we look around, we look at the news and look at all the crazy stuff that's going on in the news. We see all this, you know, a lot of just craziness that's going on. And we wonder, you know, how can these people be so blind, you know, as far as the news articles? How can these people just you know, give in to the system and just everything the news says, they believe everything? Why? Because, hey, their minds are being blinded daily by the devil. You want to know why America has a problem with homosexuality? You want to know why America has a problem with a lot of the sick, weird stuff that goes on in the United States? It's because we have a reprobate problem, folks. Amen. It's not a homosexual problem. It's a reprobate problem, okay? Because the light has been dim for so long, and the devil's never taken a vacation. I mean, it's just years and years and decades of media. This is right. This is right. This is good. This is good. This is good. This is acceptable. This is acceptable. And Christians have just backed up, haven't they? They backed up. They put their foot on the brake. They've gotten silent. They're in support of a lot of these things, you know, just silently. Well, it's okay. We just got to love everybody. God loves everybody. There's a lady sent me an email, and she said, you know, God loves everybody and all this stuff. And you know what? I didn't rip her face off because I don't know who's on the other side of that email. I don't know who it is. But I kind of kindly, you know, admonished her and sent her a lot of verses and things like that. But folks, we, you know, homosexuality is prevalent because of the rejection of God, okay? Israel, the nation of Israel, has a very high populace of homosexuals. You want to know why? Because they reject God, okay? They rejected the Lord Jesus for a long, long time. But you're going to see a lot more of these unnatural sins, the homosexuality, the pedophilia, all this garbage, because more people are rejecting the truth. Because more people are concerned with watching Netflix rather than hearing the gospel. More people are not even hearing the gospel. Churches are just a fun center nowadays. They're not actually saying anything, and we're turning into a reprobate nation. Washington, D.C., is a 2018 Gallup poll found that the United States church members has reached an all-time low of 50%, and that 1 in 5 Americans does not even identify with any religion at all. You wonder why things are getting so bad? It's because the church has been quiet. That's why they're getting so bad. You want to know why just, you know, you have a homo running for president, you know, old booty judge or whatever his name was? You want to know why that's happened? That never happened 100 years ago. Amen. That would never happen 100 years ago. You want to know why the majority of the mayors are not, well, even mayors, political offices, period, across this nation, all these women governors, all these women mayors and all these things? You want to know why that's happening? Because the church has shut its mouth. Because the church won't preach anything. Because the church is worried about a bunch of money. That's what they're worried about. They're worried about the big crowds. They want the purple lights and the big crowd and the big offering. That's what they're worried about. And you know what? We shouldn't be worried about that. We should be worried about shining the light of Jesus Christ. We should be worried about the darkness that's creeping over our nation, because we're just sitting there silently just letting it happen with all of this Christian cliches and rhetoric. Oh, well, it's never too late. It is too late. There becomes a time that it is too late for an individual. If you're not saved, hey, trust Christ today. But there is a time that it becomes too late for an individual to trust Christ for salvation. And once they cross that line, hey, the sky is the limit. Or actually, hell's the limit as far as what they're capable of doing. That's why we have the problems that we have. And everybody's afraid to say anything about it. And you talk about, hey, you think it's bad now? You wait 6 months from now. The political correctness is just off the chain now. Chris, what was it? Hate speech, you said? They passed some hate speech law or whatever, and I don't know the language of the law in Georgia. Some hate speech law in Georgia. L'Oreal, you know, with all this Black Lives Matter stuff. L'Oreal, you know what I'm talking about? The makeup, everybody know about the makeup? They have a whitening agent or something like that. If you want to kind of lighten your complexion, they're getting rid of that. They don't. I mean, is it bad to say white anymore? What color is that paper plate? You're like, I really don't want to say. I mean, is it bad? You see how weird, bizarre that is? That's weird. That's bizarre. But the majority of people will fall in line with that. Why? Because they're programmed every single stinking day. They can't get their mind unplugged, and they're brainwashed by the media every single day. Hey, unplug. If you watch television, unplug that thing and throw it in the garbage where it deserves. Get your mind, hey, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. If you constantly have your mind plugged in to the social programming of today, hey, you're never going to wake up to what the truth is. And you need to do that. But I'm telling you, society's getting worse. Everything, hey, you talk about Black Lives Matter and everything that they're applying to racial issues right now, hey, the queers are going to piggyback everything, I guarantee it. You wait for it. It'll be illegal to say queer. It'll be illegal to read Leviticus 20:13. It'll be illegal to read Leviticus 18:20 like it is in Canada right now. It'll get to the point where they'll call it hate speech if you try to preach against sodomy. And what do? Oh, well, we just need to be more loving. You need to get a spine and a backbone, Christian, and need to shine your light because the darkness is enveloping this nation. It is becoming a reprobate nation. Oh, you're just saying that because it's homosexual? No, I'm saying that we have all of this homosexual problem because that is an unnatural sin, folks. That lady in that email, she said, oh, you don't let homosexuals in your church, but do you let thieves in your church? Do you let liars in your church? You know what? You self-righteous so-and-so, whatever you are. You know what? Hey, cheating, lying, stealing, those are natural sins. Do you hear me? Murder is a natural sin. They said, oh, I guess you let rapists in your church. Hopefully, if there's any rapist in here, hopefully you'll get caught, get arrested, and put to death. Hopefully that would happen. Hopefully I just don't have a congregation full of rapists. But they throw out all these anecdotes to try to balk and scoff at us. You know, no dodo head. There's not a, you know, we don't have like just this whole commune of rapists in our church. But these people are just, you know, a bunch of naysayers, a bunch of gainsayers, the Bible calls them. But you know what? Hey, homosexuality is an unnatural sin. Do you hear me? It is unnatural. You read Romans chapter number 1, and you see all the language where it says they're given over to vile affections. It says even the women leave the natural use. What now, what do you think is more natural than Adam and Eve? Do you think anything is more natural? What do you think about something natural, something untampered with, right? Wouldn't you think something that's not been polluted, not been corrupted, not been tampered with, wouldn't you think that would be natural? Hey, I eat natural peanut butter, okay? That means it should be just peanuts and oil, right? That's ground up and put in a jar. Wouldn't you think that? Yeah. Now, if you read the label on natural peanut butter and it had hydrogenated soybean oil and it had soy lectin and it had sugar and all these things, would you think, boy, look how natural this is? If somebody with a lab coat on made your peanut butter, it's not natural. Amen. Everybody understand? You with me so far? So, what natural is something that is untampered with. It's as it comes, as nature would bring it about. What's more natural than Adam and Eve? Is there anything more? I mean, that's the first man and the first woman, okay? And they were involved in a relationship. They were husband and wife. And the two became one flesh, the Bible says. So anything outside of that is not natural. It is not natural for a man to desire another man. It is not natural for a woman to desire another woman. It is not natural for a human being to desire a child physically, to have a physical relationship with a child. That is unnatural, okay? And the only way that you can get to that point in your life, in a person's life, is if they have a mind, a rejected mind that God has given them over to, and then all of a sudden, you know, they go after that strange flesh, the Bible says. Okay? Everybody understand? You with me? We still believe this? No, I'm kidding. I'm getting worried. Lack of amens. I'm like, I'm getting worried here. But folks, and it's not an issue with homosexuality, okay? The issue is with the unbelief. The issue is with the darkness that goes on. That is the issue. That's what causes that. Homosexuality is just a symptom. It's just a symptom of a root problem, and the root problem is rejection of God. Go to Proverbs chapter 1. It's not my notes, but go to Proverbs chapter 1 because I like this verse. Proverbs chapter number 1. I like laying my notes down and that way see how many people look at their watch. Look at this. I love, look at God's language here. Look what he says. How long, ye simple ones? Verse 22, Proverbs 1, 22. Well, you love simplicity, and the scorners delight in their scorning, and fools hate knowledge. Turn you at my reproof. Behold, I will pour out my spirit upon you. I will make known my words in you. You see what he's saying? He said, how are you going to love simplicity and ignorance? How long are you going to hate knowledge? He's like, turn to me. He says, I'll pour my spirit out upon you. Hey, my Holy Spirit will deal with you. My Holy Spirit will prick your heart. Hey, it will bring you to a place of understanding the gospel. He said, I will make known my words unto you. He said, my Holy Spirit's going to work and help you understand what the gospel says. Turn you at my reproof. Look what he says in verse 24. Because I have called and ye have refused. I have stretched out my hand and no man regarded. So don't sit and tell me that God just gave up on all these people, that God just given all these people to a reprobate mind. Hey, he has exhausted all sorts of effort. Hey, he sent his own son to die for them 2,000 years ago. And he's told Christians for the past, 6,000 years of history, hey, to preach about that. Amen. To preach about the redemption of mankind. And it's our stinking fault. It's not God's. God says, I have stretched out my hand. And look what he says. No man hath regarded. Is anybody grabbing his hand? No. But ye have set at naught all my counsel and would none of my reproof. I will also laugh at your calamity. I will mock when your fear cometh. When your fear cometh as desolation and your destruction cometh as a whirlwind, when distress and anguish cometh upon you, then shall they call upon me, and I'll answer every time. It's never too late.
Nope.
I will not answer. They shall seek me early. They shall not find me. For that they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord, they would none of my counsel. In other words, they wanted. They despised all of my reproofs. Therefore shall they eat of the fruit of their own way and be filled with their own devices. Amen. For the turning away of the simple shall slay them, and prosperity of fools shall destroy them. But whoso hearkeneth unto me shall dwell safely and shall be quiet from fear of evil. Hey, God has reached out to them, and it's their fault. It is their doing. Because it's not God's doing, it's their doing. He said, I have reached out my hand, I've stretched out my hand. He says, and no man regarded. So he says, you know what? You're going to call on me one of these days? I was telling my wife the other day, we were driving and I was just kind of looking at the sky. I said, can you imagine if we're actually alive whenever the sky rolls back as a scroll? Can you imagine just driving down the road, just driving to work and that happened? Can you imagine? We will look at it and we'll be like, I mean, can you imagine what you're going to be going through at that time whenever Christ comes back and he rolls back the heavens as a scroll? Can you imagine, friends, family, people you've known been put to death, killed, you're hunted like some kind of dog, some kind of animal. Lots of people that you've known been killed, for those of us that make it to that point. Can you imagine? I mean, you're at your wit's end, you're hungry. During the tribulation, if we're still alive, you're not going to get 3 square meals. You know that.
Amen.
You know you're probably going to be thirsty.
Yeah.
You can't go to the 7-Eleven and get a Fuji water. You know what I mean? For all you yuppies. You know that ain't going to happen. You know you're probably going to be thirsty. You know you're probably going to be hungry. You know you're going to be scared. You know you're going to see friends and family get their heads lobbed off. You know that's going to happen en masse. You're going to see it every single day. Just the anxiety, the fear that you're going to be having. And then you look up and you see that the heavens roll back as a scroll. Can you imagine? The Bible says, look up, for your redemption draweth nigh.
Amen.
But you flip that coin over. Can you imagine if you've rejected the Lord? Can you imagine if you blasphemed him? Imagine if you just, you've rejoiced whenever Christians were killed. You've just been a wicked person. You've rejected God. You see the heavens roll back as a scroll. Talks about that in Revelation 6. They're crying out to the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come. Can you imagine that? One of these days, God's going to make it all right. But hey, folks, we got to go out and we got to preach the gospel, because there is a point that God has done with people. I don't know what that point is. And let me tell you something. I will tell you this, because in New IFB land, everybody wants to call everybody a reprobate, That's just like... It's like us calling each other queers when we was little. If you're my age. That's like a derogatory term. Or a girl or whatever. There's, I mean, the reprobate number, I would dare say, is growing. Why? Because we're becoming more, it's more of a godless society that we live in. But folks, not everybody's reprobate. Just because somebody's unsaved and you preach them the gospel and they don't listen to you, or they slam the door in your face or they cuss you out or whatever, that don't make them a reprobate. To be a reprobate, you think about it, to be a reprobate, it's someone that God has dealt with and dealt with and dealt with and dealt with, and God is, he's not going to stretch his arm out. He's going to withdraw. The Holy Spirit is not going to deal with that individual anymore. And God, it's not the fact that God's not going to deal with them anymore. God is going to darken their heart. Do you get that? He's going to darken their heart. He's going to blind their eyes so they can't get saved. You hear that? So they're beyond that hope of salvation. And folks, I would dare say that it'd probably be I'd hate to think, you know, God's long-suffering and his mercy before he gets to that point with somebody. Okay? So somebody you're mad at, somebody cut you off in traffic, it's not a reprobate. Okay? Somebody you get mad at, you don't like them, you don't like their Facebook posts, it's not a reprobate. Okay? You don't like the dress they're wearing, not a reprobate. Okay? Some woman come in here in pants, she ain't a reprobate. Everybody with me? It's probably a slim minority as far as considering the earth's population. The majority of people, all those Hindus over there, you know, however many billions of Hindus over there, they're deceived. Those folks are deceived. Billion Catholics on the earth, yeah. I would say you're a Catholic priest, you're a reprobate, a wicked person. You know, those people that are teaching, damning people to hell every single day. But just your average Catholic, so all these people that are going to Mass, those people are deceived. They're lost. All these people that are in the Mormon temple, they're deceived. They're lost. These two little, you know, these little Mormons that ride around their bicycle helmets and their short sleeve shirts and their red ties and all that, hey, they're deceived. Are some of them reprobate? Yeah, I'd say some of them are, but not every one of them. They need the gospel of Jesus Christ. So we don't need to have this attitude of, well, you know, the planet Earth's reprobate, except for anybody that goes to an IFB church. You know, don't have that attitude. Because we need to afford people the opportunity, because they will eventually. And I would dare say that there's lots of people that go through life and they die and they never reach that point of reprobation. You know what I mean? That they never get rejected by God. Now, realize this. Once you're dead, you're rejected by God. Yeah. You're done at that point. Yeah. There's no more opportunity. When you breathe your last breath and your heart starts beating for the last time, God's not going to bring you back and be like, all right, one more chance. We trust Christ for salvation. Once you're dead, you're dead. The opportunity's over and you would be rejected by God and you'd be cast into hell. But let's bow our heads for prayer. Father, we love you, Lord, and God, it's a sobering truth, Lord, and just help us to acknowledge it, Lord. God, that you are the God, Lord, of many, many chances. God, we don't control your mind, Lord. Something, you know, you may take more time with people that you know, we may not, Lord, if we could see, you know, the condition of their heart. Or God, you may afford them opportunities that we would deny them. God, you are just, you are holy, Lord, and everything that you do is right, Lord. And God, we trust, God, that you've given us this ministry of reconciliation, Lord. You've made us ambassadors for you, Lord. Help us to take that job seriously, Lord. Help us to shine the light as we should, Lord. God, I can't help if other churches don't. I can't help if other Christians don't, Lord, but I can help if I do. If I can let my light shine before men, Lord. And God, just help us to all have that heart. And God, just help us to embrace this truth, Lord, and just, you know, use it to be more zealous.